Hello, everyone. This is Caroline, and it's time to start our live event. Please let me know that you can hear me loud and clear as always, so we can make sure that all is working and we can go ahead with our today's live event, our IVF webinar. As you know, we have another special guest that will present another interesting topic. So I'm glad to be back. And with us today is Mireia Povedo. Hi, how are you, Mireia? Hope you can hear me.
Yes, I hear you perfectly.
I am very happy to have you here with us on board, and thank you already for joining our initiative, Stronger Together initiative. I only want to mention that all those events have been brought to you so that you can simply get to know some of the top fertility experts, but also ask your questions and to get some more information while we are still waiting. Some of them, some of you are waiting for the treatments to start. We want to simply provide you with as much help as we can, and therefore those events have been brought to you, and also they are all have been brought to you thanks to our ambassadors and partners. As always, I want to thank them for their constant support. And well, today another topic, another special guest, as I've mentioned. And so let me introduce you, Mireia Poveda Garcia. She's actually the embryologist and director of the lab at Vista Hermosa Clinic, which is located in Spain. And Mireia today will talk about IVF and donor eggs, anonymous or not anonymous. I am sure you have been asking those questions, this question quite often. So today you will be able to find out a bit more on this. But also remember, after the presentation, it will be time for your questions. All you need to do is just simply type in all the questions in the chat section, and Mireia will be answering them for you one by one. So don't miss that opportunity to ask your questions. Simple as that. And well, I guess we can start with the presentation. Mireia, are you ready to begin with the presentation?
Yes.
Excellent. Happy to hear this. Then go ahead and you can start.
Okay. Yeah, thank you, Caroline, and good evening, everyone. This time I am going to talk about anonymous or non-anonymous gamete donation. This is a topic of debate, especially in countries that maintain the donor anonymity. I will start with an introduction, and in which I will briefly explain the donation situation around the world. One of the most common questions of the patient who needs sperm or egg donor is, how would you like the process to be? Well, that depends the law of each country, because in some of them, gamete donation is forbidden. In other countries, it can only be with anonymous donor, and in other ones, they can only do with non-anonymous donor. But nowadays, thanks to the multiple traveling possibilities, patients often prefer visit centers abroad to fulfill their dreams to becoming parents, not accepting the limitation imposed by the close environment. You need to consider that your decision will have an impact not only on you, also on your future child, on the donor, and the donor child, if they have any. The potential impact of your choice is a good reason to carefully consider your options. Well, everybody knows that egg donation is allowed in a number of countries around the world. The USA is a world leader in terms of number of egg donation procedures performed annually, and Spain is the close second. These two countries have the largest and the greatest number of donor programs and the higher number of experienced clinics performing these procedures. According to the European Society of Human Reproduction and Embryology, most European countries permit egg donation in one form or in another. And there are four countries, Spain, Czech Republic, Russia, and UK, that represent about 80% of all egg donation proceeds perform in Europe. Well, that if you need one of these treatments, you must be know that there are a fundamental premise in all tonal conceptions regulation. The first one says that the recipient will be the child's real parent from the beginning. The second says that the donor has no form of paternal responsibility and may not claim any family rights. Always, if as long as regular treatment is licensed, clinics are used because informal donors may claim for a certain parentage. The first one says that the couple receive the donation become the legal parents of the child according to the general rules governing legal parentage. And the last one, and with exceptions of special cases, claiming or challenging the legal parentage of the child born as a result is forbidden. Well, with all of this context, the question is, what should potential parents consider? Well, there are many factors to evaluate when choosing the specific egg or sperm donation treatment plan. For example, rates of pregnancy, test of the donor, and one of these factors is whether to opt with an anonymous or non-anonymous donation. For this reason, it's important providing patients with a flexible dual-track system, completely with a psychological support and education that enables them to make well-informed choice that benefits all stakeholders present and future. After this introduction, I will briefly explain the difference between both types of treatment and the advantages and the disadvantages they can have. In the case of no donor, there are three types of donors. No donors, open and semi-open donors. A no donor may be an acquaintance, a co-worker, or a relative, for example, that someone, sometimes a potential no donor has heard your history and knows you are looking for an egg or sperm donor. Sometimes you or your partner may decide to ask someone to know to consider being a donor. Non-anonymous donor can be found online platforms or clinics too. In this case, profiles can also indicate where a donor is willing to be known to the intended parents and any donor considered child. In the reproduction clinics, there are two kinds of non-anonymous donor, open and semi-open donor. In the case of the open donor, is the less common form of donor arrangement. More identifying details are shared, including full names, occupations, and locations. Donor and intended parents, in this case, may meet and they may agree to get together occasionally after the baby is born. In the case of semi-open donor, personal information is exchanged, but usually not enough that communication occurs directly between the donor and the intended parent. This type of non-anonymous donation reduces some of the fears and risks to fully open arrangements. Some semi-open donor arrangements also acknowledge that donor has right to know about what happened to their gametes. There is also usually an understanding that if either the donor or the intended parent was to continue to connect, they can propose to the clinic or the agency that is handling communication. In the case of treatments with anonymous donor, the egg, sperm, or embryo donor personal details are not revealed. There is no way for the intended parents or the donor conceived child to contact to the donor, and no way for the donor to contact the intended parents and the donor consented child. Most European countries, such as Spain, Greece, Croatia, or Czech Republic, require that potential sperm or egg donor remain completely anonymous. In these countries, the donor selection is made by the medical team. Well, but in these cases, when you need a treatment with an anonymous donor, most couples having the same questions. For example, what will my baby look like, or what aspect of the donor would especially consider so that baby looks more like me. In the case of Spain, the Spanish law of assisted reproduction marks a series of requirements to guarantee the health of the baby. The law also establishes the criteria that the doctor must follow when selecting the gamete for a recipe. The same law states the impossibility for the couple to choose the physical characteristics or sex of the future babies. For this reason, the biologists were able to classify the eggs or sperm according to the existence of the greater phenotype similarities, like color, a color of the skin, and the immunological factors between the donor and the recipient. In this moment, there are clinics that use tools for selection based on facial similarity, like Phenomatch. These tools, Phenomatch is the first biometrical facial recognition program that allowed us to select the donor that look more like a patient. This type of tools guarantees the anonymous donation process. Okay, pues, the conflict arrived when trying to determine where the system is better than the other, and if so, for one, for the donor, for the recipient, or for both. Several factors must be taken into account for when evaluate the donor anonymity. These factors are the genetic aspects and the psychological and ethical aspects are the most important. In the case of the genetic aspects, there is compelling arguments against maintaining the donor anonymity if the child's health is at stake, for example, in cases of genetic inheritance of diseases. However, advances in decoding the human genome has made comprehensive that genetic testing for heritable diseases more accessible. And today, the donor are screened more than ever before. And for this reason, it would seem acceptable to removal of the donor anonymous to address the health of the child is a weak argument. Another aspect in this topic is the epigenetics. Epigenetics includes inheritable changes in gene expression and that doesn't involve change in DNA sequences. That is to say that are changes in the phenotype without changes in the genotype. These epigenetic changes are regular and natural events, but it can also be influenced by several factors such as age, environment, or lifestyle. Epigenetic markers can be primarily affected by prenatal and early postnatal environment factors. And for this reason, parents of child born after the use of the donated gamete unconsciously modify the genome inherited for the donated gamete, creating an environment that favors or inhibits the transcription of certain genes, and thus creating the phenotype of the individual. We could say that there is some genetic implication of the recipient woman in the future child. And this is one of the reasons that from the genetic point of view is given in countries that maintain the donor anonymity. In other hands, there are the psychological and ethical aspects. In this point, all of parts involved in the donation process must be taken into account: the intended parents, the donor, and the donor considered child. In case of the intended parents, they must know that parents have the right to privacy and confidentiality of the decisions. They will fulfill the role of parents based on their beliefs and values. And for this reason, it would not be logical for the state to interfere into the education of their children about their origin, unless they inflict serious damage. By eliminating anonymity, at least inconsciously, they could be more than two fathers or two mothers in the relationship, and it could remain in the psychological sphere, or it could become a reality. According to the study of Gartel, the vast majority of couples who choose a no or identifiable donor are unwilling to share parenting with the donor and prefer that they have a limited stake in their child's life. Okay. In the other hand, victims report about 144 couples and show that about 69% of recipient couples prefer the no donation. They report that this choice was primarily motivated by fears related to anonymity as well as positive feeling they had about no donor. Approximately one-third of recipient couples prefer an anonymous donor because was motivated by the wish to feel secure in the role of mother and avoid intrusions into the family's relationships. For this reason, decision about the type of donor to use is also very complex and include a number of future implications that impact in the family and in the couple. The other part of the treatment is the donor. One of the major problems with a program of no anonymous gamete donation is that it could affect the number of the gamete donors. This is an argument that frequently advances against establishing such a policy. There are counterarguments to this contention. That in 2005, legislation in UK required that donors to agree to disclose their identity when offspring reached age 18. A subsequent studies analyzed how the removal of anonymity would affect to the donor pool, and saw that the new policy would then cause a decline in gamete donation. However, there are another works carried out in this regard that show that when the donor child encountered its attempt, may don't accept and rejecting the personal encounter and prefer contact but email. And this increasing trend has been to offer a dual track system, wherein patients and potential donors elect be no or anonymous. The last part of the treatment, but no less important, is the donor conceived child. Donor identity disclosed for the emotional benefits of the child is the most controversial and is the central of the argument of protecting the right of the child to know her or his origins. Only recently have research begun studying the needs and the psychological effects of being done or consigned. It's not easy to study because the vast majority of the donor consigned adults may not even know they are donor consigned. Also, with complete anonymity, tracking down individuals to study is difficult to impossible. In this aspect, the Council of Europe has stated that is not possible at the present moment draw a decisive argument for the Convention for the Protection of the Human Rights and Fundamental Freedom, either in favor or against the anonymity of the donors. Some authors indicate that these children may be curious about the physical characteristics, family skills, and medical history of the damaged donors. Nevertheless, much of the evidence about the harm caused but not knowing one's origin is drawn from the literature on adoption, and it can be questioned whether there is the correct comparison. According to Gombloch, genetic unblendedness has a different meaning for children conceived by gamete donation than children in adopted families or step families. Okay, with all of this information, the conclusion is difficult because choosing to build your family with egg or sperm donor can be emotional and complex. Part of making that decision includes consider what kind of donor relationship you and your potential donor conceived child may benefit from. And you may also want to consider the experience of the donor and the donor of children. It's true that there are no absolute right and wrong answers. Is something to discuss carefully and carefully with a therapist, so you can feel made the best decision you could with the information you had at the time. And that is all. Thank you very much.
And thank you so much, Maria, for your presentation, for explaining all based on anonymous, whether to choose anonymous or non-anonymous donor. And just to let you know, please, if you could switch on the camera, we will go for our Q&A session. Just let me know if it's possible. Okay. So I just want to mention that we will now go for Q&A session. So, of course, we will be Mireia will be happy to answer all of your questions. So let me just remind everyone that if you have any questions, don't miss that chance to type in it in the chat section so that Mireia can help you out a bit. And there is a question ready right here. So let's get to that. Yes, all is okay. Mireia, are you ready for the first question?
Yes.
Okay, thank you so much then. Let me show you this, but I will also read it, okay? So what is your view regarding donor having a corpus luteum that is filled with some yellow liquid? She did a preliminary test which showed this. Yes. What do you suggest she should do to get rid of? Example, should she go on the birth control pill, any diet change? How quickly can she then do the cycle? Anything you could advise on that?
Okay. Hello, hi, my name is Salome Lopez, and I will be translating for Doctora Poveda.
Perfect. Salome, is it possible for you to, because we cannot see you, is it possible for you to?
Yes, of course.
Sit here so we can see you as well? Okay, excellent. Perfect. Hi. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. Okay. I'm going to answer these questions because we have seen it before. When there is that kind of corpus luteum that is filled or any other thing that it's out of the normal process, our suggestion would be changing the donor. It doesn't make any sense to do any diet change or anything to deal with the birth control pill. The best thing is to look for another donor and continue with the process with a different person.
Okay. Thank you for your question and your suggestion. One more thing, Salome, we cannot really see you, so it would be great if you could so everyone can see you when you are answering the questions as well. Thank you so much. That's much better. And thank you for that question indeed as well. And let me just have a look. We do have another question regarding the surrogate. I know surrogacy is not possible in Spain, but perhaps you can at least have a look, okay? So in your opinion, should the surrogate be screened as well as so not to express through epigenetics, genetic carrier conditions that the donor has, nor the genetic carrier conditions that my husband has? Both are different anyway.
Que siento delante la subrogada, o sea, que está prohibido. Claro. Si la epigenética tiene algo que ver.
Si la epigenética tiene algo que ver,
sí.
En la madre.
Sí.
A ver, es verdad que en el ambiente uterino se pueden generar cambios a nivel epigenético. Y lógicamente, si el útero es de una madre subrogada, pues puede haber uno de esos cambios. Pasa que en España la subrogación no está permitida, igual que en muchos países de Europa.
Sí, it is true that in the uterine ambience we can have epigenetics changes. So what you say, it can happen. But as you know, in Spain, surrogacy is forbidden. So that means that we are not very experienced in this area. So you should ask this question to a clinic a clinic that can answer to it, probably in the States, Ukraine, or any other countries that are usually dealing with surrogacy.
Of course, thank you so much still for taking that into account as well. But I will show you that there's a follow-up, so she will be our fifth donor. She has already donated twice before with good results.
Okay.
That's regarding that first question, I mean.
Mm-hmm. Sí, pues da igual, pues ella misma se la dice.
Else you could add by any chance?
No, que se ha donado otra vez y no su quinta donante, pues que ya ha donado otras dos veces con éxito. O sea, a lo mejor no es una donante para ella.
Claro, claro, es que deberían de cambiarle la donante, probablemente.
Sí, according to the doctor, maybe it's not the donor for you. Maybe they should change the donor. Maybe it has worked for someone else, but not for you. We never repeat a cycle, and we never use a donor when these things happen. Donor needs to be 100% fine.
Okay, of course. Thank you so much for clarification to this one as well. Okay, now let's have a look. We have another question. How many eggs should be transferred in a 45-year-old female who has opted for egg donation?
¿Cuántos embriones hay que transferir?
A ver, si no tiene ninguna patología que lo contraindique, podemos transferir dos embriones.
If there is no pathology that could cause any contraindication during the pregnancy, we could perfectly transfer one or two blastocysts.
Mm-hmm. Okay, excellent. Thank you once again for that question. And we are waiting for some questions. So if you have any, go ahead and type it in. In the meantime, we have another question that showed up right here. So do you know if there is any website with compliant information about national legislation regarding non-anonymity of the donor?
Sí, hay alguna web que se compila información sobre la legislación nacional haciendo referencia al anonimato del donante.
En el caso de España, tenemos la Sociedad Española de Fertilidad. Imagino que en todos los países habrá una asociación de fertilidad, si no, en la R tiene información sobre este tipo de legislación.
Sí, in Spanish case, we have the Spanish Fertility Society, where you can find that information. According to the doctor, probably most of the countries will have that kind of website. If not, regarding Europe, in the ESRE website, that's www.esre.eu, you can find that information, because you can find the legislation of most of the European countries. Anyway, if you cannot find it, you can send us an email and we can send you the link.
Okay.
It's a common question to ask.
Okay, excellent. Thank you. It's just the patient added difficulties to understand on the languages. But of course, as Salome has mentioned, okay, I'm sure that they will be able to help you. Just you can send a message, of course. I will just mention that you can also get in touch with Mireille and, of course, Salome and her team with this link, that there is an option to ask your questions, and all those questions will be simply forwarded to them. I'm sure they will be happy to help you out as well. Okay. Yeah, there is another question. Let me show you. In your experience, how many egg donor cycles might you typically expect to go through before a successful pregnancy, on average?
Sí, yo creo que para de media, hombre, en la primera la tasa de embarazo en donantes de óvulos es bastante alta, pero yo creo que con dos ciclos sería suficiente o aconsejable que se quedan.
Sí. The egg donation is a technique with a very high success rate. So most of the patients should be pregnant in the first cycle. If they are not, maybe they will need a second cycle, okay? But two cycles should be enough to have a successful pregnancy.
Normalmente también tenemos embriones congelados.
Because most of the times, in a high percentage of cases, we have also remaining embryos which are frozen. So you have the first cycle and the remaining frozen blastocysts that you could use them, or for a sibling in case you were pregnant in the first cycle, or for another transfer in case the first cycle hasn't worked. So two cycles should be enough to have a baby.
And excellent. Thank you so much once again for that clarification. And someone is typing, so let's give it a minute to see the next question. In the meantime, perhaps you can, it's off topic, but perhaps you can update us on current situation at your clinic. I understand you are reopening, etc. Can you give us some update on this?
¿Quieren hacerlo tú? ¿La situación actual en nuestra clínica? ¿Qué es lo mismo?
Okay. According to my position as the international manager of the clinic, we are already open. We are starting to receive international patients, and at the moment, all patients must be in quarantine until the 1st of July. From the 1st of July, this quarantine will disappear, and it's when most of the patients would like to come. We are having several COVID-free measures, mainly because we are part of a hospital, so all patients, we take the temperature, we need to go with masks, all the staff is COVID tested every 2 weeks, both PCR and bloods. And we are doing also the test to the patients, so they don't suffer or they don't have any risk when they come for egg collection or for transfer. As we do it here, normally we do it on the day, and we have the result on the day. And we don't know how long we will be keeping that measures, but it will depend on how our governments and European Union let us what we have to do. But we are working as normal. We have been closed for 2 months and a half, and from the beginning of May, we are fully operating.
That's excellent to hear. Thank you so much for updating us about this, because it's definitely important. Every patient is definitely waiting for such news. So thank you. And of course, in the meantime, we did receive more questions. So let me get to the first one. Does the age affect success donor and recipient?
¿La edad afecta al éxito de la donante y la receptora? A ver, en principio la edad de la receptora, si utilizamos un óvulo de donante, está minimizada, es decir, que no debería de afectar. Y sí que es verdad que las donantes a partir de 35 años, en el caso de España, no podrían donar debido a que se observa una baja respuesta y posibles malformaciones posteriores en el embrión.
Yeah. Regarding the recipient, as we are going to use donor eggs, that minimizes, okay, the success rate, so it is not such important as it should be if the baby could be spontaneous. According to the donor, the younger the donor is, the better. According to Spanish law, donors should be under 35 years old, because if not, babies could present some abnormalities. In our clinics, donors, we request they to be under 30, and normally most of them, they are in their early 20s, because yes, it affects success rates. The younger the donor, the better success rates we have.
All right. Excellent. Thank you for your question and again for your answer and assistance with this. Next question is, how long will the donor process take in Spain?
¿Cuánto tiempo? ¿El proceso de donación desde que empiezan hasta que acaba?
Pues alrededor de un mes más o menos, entre que, bueno, un mes y medio entre que seleccionamos la donante y preparamos el endometrio de la receptora, como se hace simultáneamente, es lo que solemos tener.
Normally it takes around 1 month and a half because we synchronize both the recipient and the donor. So that's why it takes a little bit longer. We try to do it always synchronized, so it should be around 1 month and a half, maybe a little bit more, but not longer than 2 months.
All right, excellent. Thank you so much again for answering that question. And we are still waiting for some more questions, so I want to encourage everyone, if you have any questions left, go ahead and type those in. This is your opportunity to ask Mireia for her for an answer. So let's just give it a minute to make sure that we have some question. If not, we will be slowly finishing. But in the meantime, if I may ask you a question that I've heard quite recently. So it's regarding anonymous versus non-anonymous question. I mean, it has been changed, for example, in Portugal, the law in regards to non-donors. Do you think, or are there any rumors that that might happen also in Spain in the future?
Es un tema que está en continuo debate, pero es verdad que en España es diferente a Portugal, porque Portugal su ley era muy restrictiva en cuanto a relación entre donante y receptora. En este caso, en España, sí es verdad que se puede saber saber el origen si hay algún tipo de malformación genética en el feto. ¿Vale? Entonces, es diferente. Puede ser que cambie, sí, pero yo creo que no inmediatamente, porque las versiones en contra son más que las de versiones a favor.
Sí, it's a very good question, Caroline. There is a continuous debate on this. No, there is much more people against changing the law that being in favor, okay, of having non-anonymous donor. The main difference between Spain and Portugal is that the law in Portugal was very restrictive between the patient and the donor. They could have an egg donation, and if the baby could have any problem or any malformation or anything, you could never contact the donor. Here you have some ways to contact the donor, keeping the anonymity. So it's a little bit different, the law that they had there and the law that we have here. We don't think that this will change immediately. And what they have been repeating once and once again is that in case it changed in a lot of years, it won't be retrospective. Okay, so patients can be relaxed about this issue.
All right, thank you so much for answering. That is definitely important. I've heard so many times those kind of things, so that's definitely encouraging as well. Thank you so much. Okay, next question is also ready, so let's have a look at this. Does the 6-week time period include finding the donor?
Sí, el periodo de 6 semanas incluye encontrar al donante. No, tendría si tuviéramos un donante.
Claro, es en el caso que haya un donante.
No, that could be in case we, what, from the moment that we have the donor and we have the screening of the donor, the 6-week time is the period that we need to take from the first stage of synchronization to the moment of the embryo transfer. But the donor is first. You need to add another 3 weeks more or less to find the donor and to have all the genetics and blood results.
And again, thank you so much for the question as well as your help with this. Next question is here as well. Does it make a difference between fresh and frozen donor eggs?
Se refiere a las tasas, sí. Las tasas son muy similares, pero es verdad que siempre son un poco más elevadas en el caso de la donante en fresco. Pero es verdad que cada vez las técnicas de vitrificación son mejores y los resultados son bastante similares.
Yeah, every time success rates are getting more and more similar. Why? Because vitrification techniques are improving daily. However, nowadays fresh cycles are having better success rates than frozen donor egg cycles. It is true that for clinics it's easier to work with frozen eggs than to synchronize both patients and recipients. And probably in the future, success rate will be exactly the same, but at the moment, fresh cycles will have a better result, slightly better result, but still better than in frozen donor eggs.
And once again, thank you so much for answering this question. All right, next question is also right here. To maximize chance of a good match, is it better to go to a big clinic as they might have more donors?
Si la clínica es más grande, ¿no? Si tiene más donantes.
Sí, es mejor ir a la clínica porque tendrá más donantes.
A ver, depende de la clínica, pero hombre, siempre cuando es más grande o más potencial tiene de captación de donantes, supuestamente más donantes tendrá, claro. Pero no tiene por qué ser mejor o peor. La verdad es que hay clínicas pequeñas que tienen buenas donantes, los estudios se han hecho correctamente y no creo que sea una diferencia en que seas grandes o pequeñas, solo va a tener buenas donantes.
According to the doctor, not necessarily, because probably they will have more donors, but they will also have more patients. So maybe there are small clinics who have very good donors and they do the screenings very well and everything is well done. And also with the clinics, there are big clinics that have a lot of donors and they are very well screened donors and others that they don't. So it depends on the clinic, not on the size.
All right, excellent. Thank you once again for explaining this question. And for now, it looks like this is our last question, but if you have any left, you know what to do. So let me go straight to this one. So for how long have the egg donation going? Do we know what is the psychological impact on children in the long run to know what that they came from egg or sperm donation?
Si tiene impacto psicológico.
En los donantes, que desde cuándo se ha estado haciendo la donación.
En el niño.
Sí, en el mundo, y que si sabemos cuál es el impacto psicológico a largo plazo, cuando saben que vienen de un donante o de una donante.
Es que el problema de esto es que los estudios todavía no han llegado, porque aunque hace tiempo que se realiza la donación, no es una técnica, o sea, que lleve como tanto tiempo para que esos niños sean adultos y que podamos ver el impacto que tiene psicológico sobre ellos. Además, contamos con que muchos de ellos no saben si son concebidos por un donante o no. Entonces, es verdad que la edad a la que puede afectar psicológicamente no es algo que esté estudiado todavía.
See, there are not nowadays important studies about this. We have been doing egg donation for decades, but there is no still people who has been screened regarding psychological impacts. And also something that we need to take into consideration is that most of the children that now are grown conceived through egg or sperm donation, they don't know that they are from egg or sperm donations, because normally parents, at least the patients that we have, and we have quite hundred of patients, quite hundreds of patients yearly, they don't tell the children. So we don't have that information yet. We will have it in some years, but not yet.
We still need to wait for some answers like this, yes? Of course. Thank you so much, though, for a very good question. Yeah, definitely something that lots of patients might actually think about. So thank you for that. And of course, for your answer to this. And well, there is a thank you from the patient as well, as you can see. All right. I'm just waiting because, again, someone is typing. So I just want to make sure whether it's another question. If not, we will be finishing for today. But I would already like to thank you, Salome, for your support today, as well as Mireia for joining our Stronger Together initiative, for being with us today. It is getting quite late in Spain as well, so thank you for just staying with us and helping out a bit as well. As you can see, there are more thank yous coming your way. So is there anything you would like to add?
Thank you very much to you all, and a pleasure if we could have helped you in anything today.
Excellent. Thank you so much once again. And of course, thank you to all of you for joining us as well over and over again, and for your questions. And then let me just mention that if you would like to get in touch with Salome and Mireia and her team, all you need to do is just simply use the link I have sent to you, but also you can simply send me an email, caroline@ivfmedia.org. I will be more than happy to forward your requests, your questions to Vista Hermosa team. I'm sure they will be happy to assist as well, as always. And well, thank you so much. And let me just remind everyone that this has been recorded. You will have a chance to watch this on myivfanswers.com. And when you are subscribing to our YouTube channel, that way you will know that the new video has been uploaded. And I can only encourage you to follow us on our Facebook page and Instagram. And that way, of course, you will be updated with all of our upcoming events. Once more, Mireia, Salome, have a lovely evening. Thank you so much. And have a lovely, lovely evening. Hope that we will be able to have you with us once again in the nearest future as well. Okay?
Thanks
okay,
so thank much. You.
Thank you.
Thanks so much. Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Bye. Thank you. Bye.